Ladies and gentlemen, and I'm happy to welcome also a gentleman here. I'm deeply honored to talk about successful women business leaders today and to share some of my personal experience with you. In order to do so, I would like to start with an introduction of my persona and my professional path. My name is Nicola Lorey. I was born and raised in Germany and completed my legal education in Osnabrück. I'm happily married and I have two sons. I discovered my interest in working international early on, which is why I chose to do parts of my studies in France. Initially, I was interested in a profession as a diplomat, as I thought this would allow me to travel and thus uphold the international component I was looking for. Although I did a traineeship at the UNESCO and my clerkship at the embassy at Geneva, I came to the conclusion that my interests were motivated by more corporate-related matters. As such, after finishing my legal education, I specialized in corporate law and M&A. In continuation, I started working in a German law firm in Paris as a business lawyer on German-French legal advisory. In May 1999, I assumed my first position as a leader at EY Law Firm, in which I managed the German legal department. This was the first time I had decisive responsibility over not only my own actions, but also the actions of others. This responsibility was broadened during the last 6 years of my time at EY, as I was responsible of all inbound activities within German-speaking countries. After 15 years of working experience at EY, I decided to take on a new challenge. I joined Holden & Partner, reorganized and managed our French office, and established the new office in Strasbourg. As of 2020, I am one of the 7 members of the Global Board of Managing Partners at Holden & Partner, as well as responsible for all our offices in France, the UK, Spain, Portugal, and the GCC states on the executive board level. Now, the question one might ask here is, how did I take on these leadership positions, considering that most studies about gender equality suggest that this is a rather challenging accomplishment for women? In fact, the average distance completed towards gender equality throughout the world is at 68%, which unfortunately, due to the pandemic, is less than last year. Moreover, there is still a significant wage difference between men and women. In France, it amounts up to 6.8%. To put this into perspective, if women earn 6.8% less than men, then in the year of 2020, they practically worked for free from the 4th of November onwards. And there is plenty more examples like. Although women have not reached equality in the working space yet, I would also like to point out some positive recent involvements that show that we are going in the right direction on female integration. This year, 56% of the Constitutional Court of Germany consists of women, which shows equal representation in one of the highest legal positions a judge can aspire to work in. Additionally, the International Criminal Court had its first female president appointed in 2017, which is one of the most prestigious titles one can acquire within the international sphere. Although we have seen significant underrepresentation of women in the job market in 2020, 50.1% of the practicing legal certificate holders in the world were female. That means women successfully transferred into a field that used to be primarily male dominated. Last but not least, in countries such as Dubai, that followed a relatively conservative approach as to women within their society in the past, we experienced more and more female contribution. This year, the gender gap in parliament was fully closed within all the United Arab Emirates. Moreover, they are currently leading on bridging the gender pay gap, as President Sheikh Khalifa issued a decree in 2020 that requires equal wages for women when performing the same work as men. So the overall number of women in high governing positions in some countries may still be quite low. Looking at myself as an example, there are some women in the highest possible positions of companies. For instance, our office in Dubai is led by a female partner and consists of a team with equal gender representation, which should be taken as a positive indicator and that we are doing the right thing. However, today I would like to focus on the aspects we as a woman may have control over. The encouraging momentum that I believe helped me on my own journey and that I would like to share with other female professionals out there. I believe the key components to successful career as a woman are commitment, cooperation, convincing courage, and individualism. Commitment is a key component since it shows willingness to succeed. As with anything in life, it is important to keep the eyes strongly on the goal. There will always be obstacles along the way, either just because of gender discrimination or simply because one is within a competitive environment. During my time at EY, as well as Rudel & Partner, I experienced a fierce competitive environment. Anyone who wanted to succeed, there was required to work hard and to fully commit to what they are doing. There is no other way to win clients. Another important element is cooperation and individualism. Cooperation with regards to the approach one has to their work. There are different ways to tackle issues in the working environment, and I suggest that instead of trying to behave like men, one should embrace the benefits of being a woman. It is not about proving that both genders are the same, nor is it relevant whether one gender is superior to the other. Both bring great assets to the table, and each company can and should profit from this. In fact, studies have shown that companies with more gender diversity on boards tend to outperform companies with less female representation. For instance, according to a study released by the Credit Suisse Research Institute from 2010 to 2016, companies with at least one female director had a better price performance. In general, I hold that a diversification allows to create bridges between all types of differences that might exist in a working environment, which is of particular relevance in times where globalization makes working together with different counterparties indispensable. We need to recognize the benefits of diverse qualities and collaborate with our colleagues to complement each other. However, cooperation is not only required by the woman, the workplace needs to cooperate with us too, which unfortunately is not always given yet. With the current lack of female integration is obstructive, another crucial issue that us women are in control of is to not take on the role of the woman. Women have the exact same intellectual attributes as men, or even better. Especially in the corporate environment, a key element is the content and the skills one contributes, and they function irrespectively of our gender. These attributes are expression of our personality, our empathic skills, and our education. At the end of the day, that is what women, just as men, should rely on, because it is what makes them valuable to a company. This brings me to the element of individualism. There may be some biological attributes we share only with our gender, but on a professional scale, we are first and foremost ourselves. As already mentioned, the attributes I bring to the table are solely mine, as I never saw myself as Nicola Lorai, the woman, but rather Nicola Lova, the lawyer, or the human being. Most of my colleagues did so as well. I think it is vital to not patronize yourself beforehand and self-attribute expectations and behavioral rules of a woman that may prevent your success at work later on. That being said, there is pressure from society that makes women believe that they have to take more responsibilities at home, working part-time for the children, and so on. According to a study done by the European Policy Department of Citizen Rights and Constitutional Affairs, this is closely linked to patriarchal structures embedded in some cultures. It is not easy to go against these expectations. But this is what today's feminism can look like. Setting an example and normalizing gender equality by living it. And another accessory component can be the support network you have because of your family and friends, as well as opportunities granted to you by people within your profession. I consider myself lucky to have had a stable supportive structure in my family and to have been given opportunities to show my full potential. Last but not least, this takes us to the final element, which is courage. To be a successful woman business leader, you need the courage to take on responsibility, to challenge yourself and to have firm confidence in yourself. One of the most frequently reported barriers to gender parity in the workforce are the lack of confidence and the lack of work-life balance. The truth is we need to believe that we can be in leader positions and we need to take on the responsibility of reaching out for these positions. I believe that today's activism of endeavoring to live the truth is becoming a reality everywhere. After working for 15 years at Ernst & Young, I took on a new challenge and changed law firms. At Wollin & Partner, I further developed my skills in entrepreneurship by expanding the French offices in accordance with our client needs. But I think more importantly, I took on more responsibility at work, and although it seemed intimidating at first for me, I believe taking on these big challenges is what enabled me to eventually become a managing partner. And because of that, I personally try to encourage young women not only in the legal sphere as much as possible, for instance by means of offering personal mentoring programs at Wollin & Partner, as well as upholding relationship with our colleagues via the hierarchical structures. As we know, there are great benefits in diversity. We tend to create a work environment that requires equal female and male representation, as well as diversity in languages, nationalities, and age. Our legal office in Paris consists of 50% female legal professionals, and almost 70% of our partners are female. To put this in perspective, the average number of women in managing positions in France is at 34.6%. Moreover, it is very untypical to experience an increase of the percentage of women when looking at higher positions. And last, but certainly not least, the future looks bright as our newest legal interns that recently joined Wollin & Partner are almost all female. Regrettably, within Germany, we only have 25.6% women partners. We achieve most equal representation in tax consulting, as we have 46 female representation with our partners. Unfortunately, in the fields of tax declaration, IT consulting, as well as auditing, the representation is less than we would wish for, which results in this rather unsatisfying total outcome. On that note, I would like to address prospect women out there that are interested in these subject matters. We need you and we would like to see you in these positions. Also on a global level, Wollin & Partner intends to have growing gender diversity. So the amount of inclusiveness in partner position is not as high as we would like to be. We have a comparatively good percentage of female partners. While other big law firms such as Allen Overy, Clifford Chance, Linklaters and clearly Gottlieb have female partners in the range of 25% to 40%, we are proud to say that our partners consist of 45% women. The same goes for our board members. At the moment, we have 29% women sitting in the board, me included. We would like to see more. However, the average of the OECD member states is at 25.6%. And we are happy to maintain an above average female representation here as well. In general, female inclusiveness is something we encourage at Hulland Partner. So we have not accomplished absolute equality in all areas yet. We continue thriving to create more opportunities for women. It is a journey we still have to face, but I have faith in continuing to work together so we can reach this compelling goal.